And we can, proceed like that. So, with Governor Sir's permission, sir, we go ahead.
Akri, you are muted. Where's the company? Where's the company? Not coming.
Just a few moments more. Good afternoon to all of you. Once again, I welcome the governor and deputy governors for this press conference. And as I mentioned earlier, we'll have an orderly arrangement in this press conference. I'll call out the names of the persons who are requested for asking questions so we can make the best use of time. Good afternoon, sir. May I start the proceeding, sir?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Sir, thank you, sir. So I will request Lata Venkatesh from CNBC to start her question, please.
Okay. Thank you very much for the opportunity, Governor. First question I have is that Reserve Bank had given this forward guidance of accommodative stance into the next year. The market had understood it as June. Would you want to extend it well into 2021 calendar? As well, you have started normalizing by introducing the variable rate reverse repo for 14 days. By when can we expect a full normalization of the entire LAF proceedings into variable rate? And of course, the internal committee of the monetary policy review of inflation targeting, when is that expected, sir? Thank you.
Thank you. Before I reply to your question, I just want to mention one point by way of information. This is very important from RBI's point of view and from the point of view of financial literacy. Every year in February, we celebrate the Financial Literacy Week. This year, the Financial Literacy Week would be observed from 8th February to 12th February on the theme Credit Discipline and Credit from Formal Institutions. And RBI and all the banks and other entities are fully geared to carry out this tasks of the Financial Literacy Week. We consider this as very important. Now, coming to your question, the market has its own way of interpreting things. We have said that accommodative stance into the next year. We have not said anywhere June. And the situation is constantly, the economic situation, the overall situation, macroeconomic situation is constantly evolving. And so we will take a call, but we have not spelled out June as the, you know, date by which, you know, this forward guidance would end. And then the second question which you asked was about, can you just repeat that?
So this variable, you have started the, you know, variable rate reverse repo auction. So when will you normalize the entire LAF operations? What is the timetable, if you can give a guidance?
No, you see, I think if you go through the, my statement has now been uploaded in the RBI website. My statement is now there in the website. Our MPC resolution is also there in the website. If you see it very careful, you know, what we have said is that I have explained what exactly the variable rate reverse repo auctions means. It is a part of our toolkit, which was very much there before the pandemic set in. And we have overall, you know, if you see the overall liquidity remains the same. And out of that, a certain portion is taken under the 14-day very, you know, reverse repo window. Yes. Otherwise, the total liquidity available to the banking system remains the same. And I have explained this question of normalization, I mean, what you are referring to as normalization. I have put it in the proper context and explained it. And our liquidity stance at the moment continues to be accommodative and is in consonance with the overall monetary policy stance of being accommodative. So I'll stop here. Yogesh, please.
Thank you, sir. May I request Madam Maitri Vasunmat from ET now to ask her question?
Thank you, Yogesh, and thank you also, Governor. I'm taking off from where Lata left on the forward guidance of keeping monetary policy accommodative. This was presumably based on the assumption earlier that the fiscal deficit would be in the range of 6 to 7%. Now that we know it's going to be around 9.5% this year, and maybe 6.8% next year, and maybe even these are underestimates, was there any discussion in the MPC on the wisdom of such long-term guidance, particularly since it seems to have boosted asset markets more than the real economy? And earlier, there was an MPC member who expresses reservations about the use of the word decided in giving forward guidance. And if I may follow Lata's example and ask a second question, you know, you had said that the evolution of an orderly yield market is a public good. Would you like to qualify that, say that it is a public good, not for all stakeholders, but for some stakeholders, but for because for savers, it has definitely not been a public good. They are getting negative real rates of interest. So two questions, Governor.
With regard to the MPC deciding, you said that earlier one member had a different point of view. This time, both components of our decision, whether it relates to the rate or it relates to the stance, both the decisions this time are unanimous. And even in the last meeting also, both the decisions were unanimous. And with regard to orderly evolution of the yield curve, we had said public good. And I would not agree that it is only for one segment of the market, that is the G-Sec market. Basically, the G-Sec yields are the benchmarks on which the entire corporate bond markets and the, you know, the all the bonds are priced. So the bond pricing, as well as the host of other, activities, other segments of the financial market, the corporate bond market, even to some extent the bank lending approach and the rates are also influenced by the G-Sec rates. So they act as the benchmark and the base on which all these other segments, their interest rates and yields are built up. So therefore, it is a public good because eventually it impacts, the G-Sec yields impact a wider cross-section of the financial markets, and I had said that financial stability and orderly evolution of yield curve are public goods. I had said it earlier, and I have again repeated it this time also.
Except for the savers, Governor.
Well, that is another call. I mean, the banks, naturally, when the banks sort of are reducing their, you know, when the banks are reducing their lending rates, naturally, part of it also goes to the savers. For savers, we must also recognize that the small savings schemes which government runs, or the RBI deposit scheme which we run, I think there are other avenues where small investors, small savers can use those facilities. And so that is how I would like to reply to that. And that's it. Okay. Thank you.
May I request Ida Duggal from Bloomberg PIN to ask her question, please?
You have to unmute.
Governor, if you can hear me now, I'm saying that I'm really veering away from monetary policy this time around because of the exciting announcement on G-Sex and retail access. I know the details are yet to be announced, but could you just give us some sort of understanding on what direct accounts with the central bank would mean? What would be the nature of something like this? And would it be too much of a leap to say that if this experiment were to work well, it in some ways gives us a guardrail or you know, some rails on which to build access to a central bank digital currency, sir?
I would just like to say that this is a major structural reform. I have described it as a structural reform, and I'm doing so because world over, very few countries have done that. And as far as I know, I think very few countries like United States and Brazil have that. And in Asia, we are the first country to do it, as to the best of my information. And it has been our endeavor, both government and the RBI, for a long time, to make the G-Sec market accessible to retail investors. And we have this aggregator model through stock exchanges and other kinds of access which we have provided. But now we are giving a direct access to the retail investors. And about the modalities and all, I would request our Deputy Governor, Mr. Kanungo, to supplement. With regard to digital currency, I think our document on, we have already released it, our digital payment document spells out the digital currency. It is a work in progress in the RBI. So I would pass on the question with regard to these individual gilt accounts. Mr. Kanungo, Deputy Governor, could elaborate on that.
Thank you, Governor, and thank you, Ira. As Governor has already mentioned, this is a very significant development. As you know, for the last so many years, we are trying to broad-base the government securities market, and with the size of the government borrowing, it is absolutely necessary that the investor base is broadened. So this is an important step that has been taken. So far, we had with the retail investors, they were in a position to access the NDSO through an aggregation model. I mean, the stock exchanges, they were allowed to aggregate the demand and place it with the Reserve Bank of India in the NDSO. Now, going forward, we thought that we should move beyond this, and you and I can place a direct bid with the NDSO system for our requirement of the government securities. And in the interest of the DVP system, what it entails is that this is a paradigm shift, that you and I also can open a gilt edge account with the Reserve Bank in the e-Kuber system. So that is what it is, that it will be a direct participation in the government securities market in the bidding process, and in operationalize that, the individuals will be opened, will be allowed to open a gilt account in the Reserve Bank's e-Kuber system. Please wait for the details. We are coming out with the details very soon. And as Governor has mentioned, the central bank digital currency, you would recall that it was a monetary policy announcement long back. Then we had a committee that is still on the drawing board. In fact, an internal committee is taking a close look to decide on the model of the central bank digital currency. And you will hear from the Reserve Bank very soon in the matter. Thank you.
Thank you, sirs. May I request Mr. Govardhan Rangan from Economic Times to ask his question?
Thank you, Vish. Good afternoon, Governor. Sir, you predicted 10.5% growth for next year. At the same time, you have mentioned about cost push inflation pressures. And still you have kept an accommodative stance. How do you justify that accommodative stance when these two factors are strong? And at the same time, you have staggered the withdrawal of the CRR benefit that you gave banks, and you have kept that SLR benefit of the held to maturity benefits that also goes off in 2 years. How do we read both these measures, which appear to be kind of a conflicting thing?
I will answer the first part of the question, and second part I will pass on to Deputy Governor Dr. Patra. You know, with regard to the 10.5% growth for next year, which we have projected and we have referred to cost push factors, all these aspects have been taken into account and have been duly factored in our projection for the CPI inflation, which we are saying will be 5.2% in the current quarter, and then going forward 5.2 and then 5, and I think thereafter it is 4.6. So all these factors are taken into consideration while giving that projection. So based on that, we have decided to, the MPC has decided to continue the accommodative stance. And I would now request Dr. Patra to supplement and reply to the next question on CRR SLR.
Thank you, Governor. Govardhan, if you recall, when we announced the CRR reduction, we had said then that it would be normalized on March 27th of this year. We gave a full year of dispensation and decided to normalize it on March 27th. But we went one step forward. What we did was we did not normalize it in one step. We normalized it in two steps, so that 50% will happen on March 27th. And 50% is pushed to May. And if you have heard Governor speaking in the morning, what he said was that the withdrawal of liquidity through CRR will be replenished through more durable liquidity in other forms, which are more market friendly. As regards the dispensation on HTM, the RBI is very conscious that the borrowing program of the government needs to go through in a smooth manner, just as it happened last year. Just as RBI did several things last year to ensure a smooth, seamless borrowing program, we will ensure the same for this year, given the size of the borrowing program. And that is why the HTM dispensation. It is essentially to help banks deal with new issuances of government securities during the year as part of the borrowing program, while protecting their balance sheets from interest rate risks.
Thank you. So we take that a normalization has begun, it is going to be staggered.
In case of every normalization, Govardhan, you have to cross the river by feeling the pebbles. We will calibrate it to how the market responds, how market sentiment pans out. It will not be a programmed and a cold turkey method. It has to be in sync with the market sentiment.
Thank you, sir. May I request Swati Khandelwal from Zee Business to ask her question, please?
Yeah. Thanks, Yogesh. My question to Governor is, sir, can you see me?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, my question. Yes, sir. So my question is about the NBFC guidelines and the work that's been done so far. Sir, that we will see, and any meetings, etc., lined up to get the final shape. What are the kind of timelines that you've set in mind for the NBFCs and their way forward, sir?
Is the NBFC discussion paper is out, and I think we have called for comments and we have given time up to, we have given 30 days time. The document was released around 22nd or 23rd of January. We have given 30 days time. So once the comments come in, we will examine that and take it forward. The key thing to be noted about the NBFC document is that the kind of focus it is giving on all aspects of governance. And that is something which you would see in our overall approach running through, you know, whether it relates to banks or it relates to NBFCs or it relates to the urban cooperative banks. I think the focus on governance is the key thing that you will see as the common underlying theme on all our regulatory and supervisory approaches to various segments of the market, particularly banks, NBFCs, and these things. So Once we get the comments, we will take a decision in this regard. And may I also just request all parties, you know, all of you to please just confine yourself to one question so that we are in a position to entertain, you know, more questions from more number of participants. Thank you. Sure. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. We'll keep that in mind. May I request Anoop Roy from Business Standard to ask his single question?
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Sir, one question about this retail direct scheme. It's a great scheme. Just one clarification. Have you considered what impact it will have on banks' deposit mobilization and the mutual funds, etc., all these fixed income schemes? They will be rendered probably useless by, you know, savvy investors. Particularly, what impact it will have on the banking system as far as deposit mobilization is concerned? What's your assessment, sir, on that?
I think, you know, the as the GDP grows, as the country records, you know, as the Indian economy comes back to a higher growth trajectory, as the size of the economy grows, the total volume of savings and deposits, naturally, it will expand. And the banks have so many other functions and so many other services which they render. So we feel that it will not undermine the flow of deposits to banks or mutual funds. It is one more avenue which is now made available. The process has been made now much easier. And in any case, please remember that even today, the small savings rates offer much higher you know, rates than the bank deposits. Notwithstanding that, the bank deposits this year have grown by 11.3%. That is the deposit growth. So we don't feel that it will in any manner cut into the bank deposits. I think the size of the pie is too large to support. And this is a kind of a new access which we are giving.
Thank you, sir. May I request Bijoy Editoria from Informist Media to ask his question, please?
Thank you. Thank you, again, sir. So just a quick question on, you've spoken about how the markets and you've been trying to manage how the markets understand your communication and, you know, the disconnect that had happened. But there still seems to be a disconnect in the market's choice of what they would like to see as tools from the RBI and what the RBI seems to be providing, whether it is variable rate and how it was seen by the market, or the fact that OMO sizes are now at 10,000, even though the RBI had initially said 20,000. So is there any communication that you would want to share on exactly what the liquidity framework is for the markets at this point of time?
You see, what happens sometimes the market takes a little more time to probably, you know, understand our communication. And over a period of time, the markets do have a better appreciation of what is our communication. With regard to the OMOs, we had announced that we will now enhance the OMO to, you know, to 20,000 crores. But then the situation is constantly evolving. We have a mix between the operation twists and direct OMO purchase of 20,000 crore. Then we made 10,000 crore. That was based again on a certain kind of market feedback because the system was already flushed with 6.5 lakh crore of liquidity. So it was in a specific situation that we had taken this situation, you know, taken that decision. And it's a constantly evolving, you know, the situation is very dynamic, and we will use all the instruments. That I think I have said it in my statement very clearly. In fact, you know, now that my statement is there in the public domain in the website, I think the liquidity guidance that we have provided would not have been more explicit than what it is. So I'm sure the market will slowly, you know, they will appreciate it over the next, you know, next few days.
Thank you, sir. May I request Sri Pradeep Pandya from CNBC to ask us to ask his question?
धन्यवाद योगेश जी. मेरा सवाल बैड बैंक पे है गवर्नर साहब. बैड बैंक को लेकर के बैंकर्स और इन्वेस्टर्स के बीच में काफी एक्साइटमेंट है. हम ये समझने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं कि आपके बयान में हमने सुना था कि एक एआरसी होगा लेकिन बजट भाषण और उसके बाद के कुछ बयान में आया कि ये दरअसल एक एसेट मैनेजमेंट कंपनी होगी। दरअसल किस तरह का स्ट्रक्चर होगा, इस पर किस तरह की बातें चल रही हैं और इसके पूरे स्ट्रक्चर को लेकर कितने लोन वगैरह उसमें जाएंगे, क्या फैसला लिया गया है, अगर आप हमें इस पर थोड़ी रोशनी डाल सके और ये कब तक पूरा हो जाएगा?
देखिए, इसमें बैड बैंक के बारे में पहले तो डिस्कशन मतलब हुआ है, सरकार और फाइनेंस मिनिस्ट्री और आरबीआई के बीच में डिस्कशन हुआ है। ऐसा नहीं कि बिल्कुल डिस्कशन नहीं हुआ है, डिस्कशंस हुए हैं इसके बारे में। और अभी का जो सिचुएशन है, वी आर मतलब वो गवर्नमेंट से फॉर्मल उनका जो प्रपोजल है वो हम अवेट कर रहे हैं, वो एक्सपेक्ट कर रहे हैं। जब वो फॉर्मल प्रपोजल आ जाएगा फिर उसको हम एग्जामिन करके उसके ऊपर एक व्यू लेंगे। जब तक फॉर्मल प्रपोजल हमारे पास नहीं पहुंचता है तो हमारे लिए ये ठीक नहीं होगा, ये सही नहीं होगा कि हम उसके बारे में एक मतलब कुछ प्रीमैच्योरली उसके बारे में कुछ बयान दे दें। तो वी आर वेटिंग फॉर द फॉर्मल प्रपोजल फ्रॉम द गवर्नमेंट।
थैंक यू सर। मे आई रिक्वेस्ट मिस्टर अनिर्बन नाग फ्रॉम ब्लूमबर्ग टू आस्क हिज क्वेश्चन।
Thank you, Yogesh ji. Hello, Governor. Good to see you. My question to you is in reference to paragraph 13 in your statement, where you bring about the forex inflows because of risk appetite. Part of the reason is a lot of people tell us is because of the high forward premium that is there in the market, which is encouraging the carry trade. Is there something that you want to do about that forward premium rates?
No, we are very watchful and about the forward premium rates, and it's not off our radar. And there are now, you know, the globally there is a lot of liquidity floating around internationally, and as I mentioned in my statement, India continues to attract a lot of forex capital inflows now, and so the forward premium we are watchful, and we will you would have seen if you go by our track record, we have taken measures as and when we consider it necessary, and that's it. I mean, we'll take steps when it becomes necessary. Dr. Patra, would you like to supplement?
Thank you, Governor. Anirban, our first objective is to protect our domestic markets from these high global spillovers. And you know that there are very high surges of capital inflows. And not only that, there's a hunt for yield. And obviously, we have to protect our markets. Our markets will remain domestically oriented. So to that extent, they are premium spikes. We are watchful of them. But through our market operations, we will ensure orderly conditions in all segments of the markets.
Thank you, sir. May I request Mr. Mayur Shetty from Times of India to ask his question, please?
Thank you, Yogesh. My question, Governor, is on consumption demand. The policy is very optimistic on revival. So is it clear now that all the growth numbers are being driven by fresh consumer demand and not pent-up demand as it was seen earlier?
That is becoming increasingly evident, and we have been tracking high speed indicators. Our list of high speed indicators which we monitor is fairly long, and in almost all segments we are seeing a sort of growth of demand. So therefore, the demand has now moved beyond pent up demand to actual demand coming up, and as the lockdown gets steadily lifted and the movements are allowed across the country, within cities and across the country. So therefore, the demand will pick up. So it is no more a pent-up demand. And I think things are expected to be now, the demand curve is expected to be now much more sustained.
Thank you, Governor.
Thank you, sir. May I request Ms. Gopika Gopakumar from Mint to ask a question?
Thank you, Yogesh sir.
Governor, in your this is on this asset quality of banks. In your stress test, you had mentioned that the gross NPA of banks will go up to 30%, 13.5% by September. Now, this differs from the projection of banks and rating agencies, and of course, the market wants to know whether there will be a rethink or will RBI revisit how these stress tests are done. So that gives a clearer picture to the market about any imminent risks. Could you clarify on that?
You see, the stress tests, the model of the stress tests have been there for quite some time. And we sort of do them under various scenarios. We do them under the baseline scenario. We do it under moderate stress. We do it under the severe stress. And if you see the baseline scenario that we have projected is that it will be 12.5%. And we are collecting the data from various, from the banks with regard to the size of their individual stress, what kind of NPAs they are reporting. We are, apart from what comes out in the media, our supervisory process also, as a part of our regular supervision, we do an independent assessment of the actual, the true state of NPAs that the banks have. And we also take it up with the banks to make provisions in their accounts proactively. And I'm happy to note that many banks have very proactively made provisions in anticipation of higher NPAs, and that's a very positive development. That's a very positive feature of the banking sector, in the sense that there is wide realization in the banking sector that they need to provide adequately for the buildup of stress. So therefore, we are constantly monitoring it, and the impact of the standstill which is there on asset classification, the impact of the resolution framework, COVID-related resolution framework, all this data is flowing into us on a daily basis. So we will take we will have a clearer picture as we move ahead.
Thank you, sir. May I request Mr. K. Ramkumar from Hindu Business Line to ask his question?
Thank you, Yogeshi. Governor, sir, I just wanted to know about, this economic survey is calling for a asset quality review once the regulatory forbearance is removed, actually. So I just wanted to know your thoughts. Will RBI do a second kind of AQR? Thank you.
I just mentioned that, in our supervision, as a part of our supervision, and I have said this before also, in the last 2 years or so, we have really deepened our supervision. In the context of NBFCs, I had said it 2 years ago, that short of announcing an AQR, our supervision is doing a deep dive to get a clear picture about the true state of affairs with regard to the non-performing assets or the bad assets and the stressed assets. Similarly, with regard to the banks, it is a part of our supervisory process. We are doing a deep dive into their, as I just mentioned in the previous question, we are making our own assessment of the true state of the NPA in each of the banks. So we have a sense of the overall situation. So we are exactly doing what an AQR needs to do. And that's already happening as a part of our supervision.
Sir, may I request Ms. Swati Bhatt Shette from Thomson Reuters to ask a question?
Good afternoon, sir. Thank you, Yogeshji. I just wanted to understand, Governor, with the government having taken a bold decision to announce higher fiscal deficit, we are actually moving away from the glide path which was originally projected. So are you aware of any discussions that happened between the government and rating agencies prior to taking this bold decision? And is this likely to have any rating impact on India now that we've taken this move? Thank you.
Rating impact, I would not like to comment. It's for the rating agencies to take their own view. All these, the matters, because it has an impact on the borrowing, obviously, these things are discussed between the finance ministry and the Reserve Bank of India before the budget also. And the Finance Commission has given a glide path. The deviation from the FRBM, previous FRBM targets was quite inevitable, considering the impact of the COVID pandemic when the government revenues, not only of the central government, but state governments, all the revenues crashed for a few months. But now it is good to note that the GST revenues have not only come back, but they are actually showing better collections. So there is a glide path which the Finance Commission has given, and the Finance Minister has also mentioned that they would be coming out with a glide path so as to reach 4.5% of fiscal deficit by 25-26. So we will wait for the government to take a final view on this and go forward. So far as RBI is concerned, we are, what concerns us is the, as the debt manager of the government, what concerns is the overall government borrowing program and the debt to GDP of the government, because we have to manage the debt, and it is already under discussion between the government and the RBI. It was an extraordinary situation, I think, which happened over the, it's a once in 100 years kind of extraordinary situation. So that's, we have to see the, deviation in that context. But we are confident of dealing with the overall situation in the sense that the current year's borrowing program, we are confident of managing it in a very non-disruptive and seamless manner. Please go by our track record. We did it in 2021. We have done it in 2021. The lowest borrowing cost in last 15 or 16 years. The average maturity has also got elongated. I have given the figure in my statement. And we are confident that going forward in 21-22 also, we will be able to implement government borrowing program in the most non-disruptive manner. So let there not be any doubt about this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We are almost out of time now, but may I request you to take one or two more questions before we close? So with your permission, I'll invite Hitesh Vyas from PTI to ask his question.
Hello, can you hear me, sir?
Yes,
hello. Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead, yeah.
Sir, my question was regarding PNC Bank. There were three potential investors who were given time till February 1st to submit their final offer. So have they submitted their offer, and any decision being taken on that?
I have been informed. Please switch off. Please put your mic on mute. Hitesh, please put your mic on mute. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Hitesh. So I have been informed that three bids have been received. The final offers have been received. And again, I'm given to understand that the PMC Bank itself is evaluating the offers. They received it, I think, on 1st of February. Today is the 5th of February. They are evaluating it. And they will approach us after their evaluation is over for any regulatory, it would require certain regulatory permissions and clearances. So they will approach us. It is under evaluation. Three offers have been received. They are under evaluation by the bank. That is what I have been informed.
Thank you, sir. And may I request Mr. Ankur Mishra from Financial Express to take the last question, please?
Sir. Good afternoon, Governor. I wanted to understand that what was the thought process behind allowing the retail gilt accounts, and will there be some ceiling? Essentially, will there be any definition of retail? If you can clarify.
I think I would suggest you. The intention behind it. I have mentioned it, and Mr. Kanungo, Deputy Governor, has also explained it. It's basically to give access to the retail investors to the GSEC market. And it is one more option which we want to provide to the retail investors. And with regard to the other aspects which you are mentioning, I would request you please wait for our guidelines in this regard. We will provide clarity in that.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. And with this, I think we should come to a close of this press conference. I would like to thank the governor and the deputy governors for making it interactive, and all of the participants from all the media houses for being patient and a support to participate with us. We look forward to more future interactions. Thank you. Good day and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. for your participation.